Hello, and let's talk about sport and the US elections. We're talking, of course, of two fields in life where there's a lot of money, and as can be guessed, there's a great nexus as well. Now, sportspersons across the world and from the US have also been in the forefront of many causes. We know the role of iconic sportspersons such as Muhammad Ali and the Black Power salute given by American athletes Tommy Smith and John Carlos at the 1968 Olympics. In recent times, we've seen basketball players, for instance, take a stand following the murder of George Floyd in May. The basketball players were demanding justice. But this is just one side of the story. The role of sports in politics would be incomplete without discussing the role of owners of sports teams, who are often very rich, of course, and the supporters of the establishment, upholding it and often very much a part of it. Now, this is true as much of the US as of India and many other countries in the world. And so ahead of the US elections, we talked to NewsClick's Leslie Xavier on the situation with the sports establishment in the US and also the scene in India when it comes to politics.
So the US presidential elections are scheduled to be held tomorrow. That's November 3rd. And it's a very important election as far as the country is concerned, even the world, all of us sitting even in India. And we do know that sportspersons, especially over the past few years, they've been in the news for a lot of political reasons as well. Even before the elections, there was Colin Kaepernick, Megan Rapinoe and the US football team. The basketball players who during the peak of the Black Lives Matter movement were actively involved. So with this election cycle happening both for the presidential election and for Congress, are sportspersons getting involved? So what's been happening there?
That's a beautiful narrative, right? I mean, democracy at play,
right.
Everybody has a voice, unmuscled. And the sportspersons are standing up for what is right and making a social stance, and everything is lovey-dovey over there. Democracy is healthy and elections are free and fair, and only in America, they say. But yeah, there is a larger picture to this, larger powers at play, which is
right.
I mean, which has come out in a nice and detailed way. ESPN has brought out a 6-part coverage, a story series on this, who are the real power brokers in American sport and the impact that they have in everything. I mean, not just the sporting arena, but as you can see, how the sportspersons have a reach within the society and how they're making stands. Obviously, the businesses would have a larger reach, and so that's it's actually pretty. I mean, a few pretty damning revelations are there in those stories. But yeah, before getting into that, yeah, of course, yeah, sportspersons have made their stance last. I mean, it is actually very heartening to see, because it's something that we don't see across the world, and especially in India, we don't see at all that kind of a social or political stance being taken by our sporting heroes.
Right.
And they have realized their worth, they have realized their value, and they also realized their responsibility to society. I mean, so all these things are great. But beyond that, how American sport works is of course, we call it professional sport. We call it the epitome of that idea of quality in sporting arena plus the business and the money-making.
Right.
Side of it. It has changed lives of these athletes who are there at the pinnacle, for sure. But then it is capitalism at play. It is. So with that comes that idea of pushing one's businesses using whatever means that is available. They call it enterprise. But we can call it, depending on where we stand, we can call it different names. So most of the team owners in American professional sport happen to be Republicans or Republican sympathizers, Trump sympathizers, mostly because they feel that Trump can protect them with all these benefits like taxation-wise or rules-wise, I mean, to aid their business. And we are talking about business that runs into, I mean, it's multi-billion dollar industry, sporting industry in the US. We are talking about NBA. NBA is not actually the biggest over there. Major League Baseball and football, NFL, these two are bigger than NBA. WNBA, the motorsport leagues, NASCAR, etc. So it's huge, and so these owners have a huge say, obviously, because such an industry, it's like any lobbying done by any industry for that matter, gun lobby or real estate lobby or whatever. So everybody is involved in that election. That's how American electoral system works, and so there are set rules by which these people or these entities can put in money, contribute money to the campaigns. And that is a legit system by which the US works. But beyond that, there are these under the table deals as well, where they bypass the loopholes in the system to put in money, the funding without it being out in the public domain, without it being obvious. So in one of the ESPN stories, there has been a source has been quoted as saying, a source who is within this circle of team owners of the NBA, specifically NBA, the 30 most richest people in American sport, right, and obviously the NBA. So they all feel, so of late there have been a lot of political discussions as such. And so this source provided some insight on how things work. So for instance, if someone has to put in money which he doesn't want to come out in the open or come in the IRS radar, so they can use organizations which needn't reveal the source of the person who is giving that money. And then in turn, that organization can give it to another organization which would be directly linked to the campaign or directly be funded into Trump or Joe Biden for that matter. And this is not exactly a Trump president. This has been there. So Trump is probably using it the best way possible. After all, he's a businessman more than a politician or a statesman. So that's a very murky picture that has emerged from that the picture that is not portrayed at all in the major narrative that comes out as far as sport and US politics and US society is concerned. So what is coming out is these sports persons being woke and being active and being openly campaigning against Trump, and hopefully that is going to sway the votes and all that. But from the other side, the real power dealers who probably has a larger say in it because they are pumping in the money, they are hopeful that they understand, obviously, that Trump is not exactly a great guy to have. But they also, so in that sense, they are hoping that they are hoping that the Democrats will have a majority in both houses. Right. But at the same time, Trump remains at the helm so that he can block things that go against their interests.
Absolutely.
So that is real democracy, if you ask me. That's at play, on par with any of the democracies, any of those, celebrated democracies, including ours. sadly. It's actually very murky, and it's also what the real state of the world is at present. Nothing is clear, and the real players who keep on swaying things in their interest, in their favor, they keep on playing, and there's no check or there's no way to stop this. I won't call the system entirely corrupt, but the system is hardwired to incline towards corruption. So that's how it is. That's the reality there.
Absolutely right. Yeah, so in this context, it's interesting to look at India also, where this kind of professional sport has been picking up over the past few years, in the sense of the leagues and the big money coming in, the big sponsorship deals, of course, and that actually entering almost every tier of sport, so to speak. And we do have examples like the IPL, where big business is very closely entrenched with big sport. Earlier, it was just one sponsor for the national team, maybe. So we had a Sahara sponsoring the Indian cricket team for the longest time. But now there are obviously so many more players who are business players who are in the picture. So how do we see the situation in India?
We can just define it in one sentence, if you ask. If you just try to understand who exactly owns big Indian sport. So first, let's start with football and the Indian Super League. The stakeholder is FSDL, which has it's directly owned by Reliance IMG. And so I'm just laughing because all these big companies in India, they all have a huge stake in Indian sport and the professional sport as such. Understandably, it's business, so business interests businessmen, and there is money to be made over here. One reason why, if you look at football specifically, there are these European clubs coming into town. They want tie-ups with ISL clubs. They want to start academies. It's not academies that they're interested in. It's not to develop Indian football as such, but it's to develop that ecosystem where they could sell their merchandise, they could sell their brand over here, they could make money out of it. It's pretty simple, the dynamics. And if they bring in value, of course, and as far as their expertise and these academies might be helping young talents, etc. But ultimately, that is how the business is run, and it's owned by one of the biggest companies in the country.
Right.
And the same, if you look at IPL, BCCI owns it, but then the stakeholders are many in it. The sponsorship deal apart, the individual franchise owners are right. owned. I mean, franchises are all owned by big businesses like Chennai Super Kings and India Cements, Mumbai Indians and Reliance again. So, and a couple of Bollywood superstars owning companies, Wadia Group owning one team. So when these contracts are signed with these players, they're obviously bound, and bound to the interests of that company. That's how contracts work. That's how employment contracts work right. as well. So. It's normal employment company, not such sports person. So they fall in line, and these companies of course all these business houses, you know how, I mean, the lobbying system is not by law supposed to happen in Indian democracy that way compared to the US. But then we all know, I mean, fund collections, it starts from the local level where
right.
I remember as a youngster, buckets going around and funds being collected. And then, of course, the buckets are larger and bigger and much more. The scope is much bigger when it comes to the national politicians. So all these big firms, I mean, they're pumping money into the government. And so the players which are directly under these companies, they can't stand against the government because it's the connection of the dots is pretty obvious and simple, just as nobody exactly. talks about it.
Exactly.
So when we have been critical in our discussions as well, when we talk about Virat Kohli not standing up and talking against atrocities happening against students in the JNE, for instance, or the Jamia instance, or the Delhi program. So, of course, he can't because he is entrenched in this, he is shackled in it. He doesn't probably realize it. So, if a person like a Kohli or who can sell thousands of Nike jerseys because he endorses Nike. I'm just giving an example. Right. I'm not sure whether Virat is a Nike ambassador. But whatever brand, if he can sell that, imagine the kind of sway that he has among people. But he won't because he's tied, and without even realizing, he's shackled into the system by the system. So,
right.
so that and that's one side of it. We are just speaking about the business side of it. But when you look at administration in sport, exactly. that's another part altogether. And it's in that regard, probably US is better because in the US. Politicians have little say in how the sport is run. The sporting body, the U.S. Olympic Association or the U.S. Football Federation. It's. I mean, of course, you can't say it's completely independent as such. Mm-hmm. But then there is no direct involvement,
right?
That way. But here, if you look at it, all the sporting bodies, all the sporting federations, right at the helm, 2-3 rungs, it's all politicians. And mm-hmm. State bodies, the state level politicians are there.
So
again, a football or a athlete or a wrestler or a boxer, they obviously can't talk about anything remotely political or remotely social because everything is connected here.
Right.
Remotely religious or whatever, because from the top, the order will come, and he will never see the national team again after that. It's as simple as that. The payback or the punishment is
right.
Will be direct and huge, and they will kill their career altogether.
Absolutely.
So that's other side. So in the Indian scene is why our athletes are silent. Of course, this is the reason why they are silent, and a collective effort, if it comes from the athletes together, I don't know whether they will be able to break the system at all, because the system is so interested in this. And again, in this context, it's a very recent, it's a ongoing thing that is happening in Nigeria, the protest against the police atrocities over there. Ironically, the police unit is called SARS. And so there, one footballer, John Ogu, who is a midfielder, who is with the national team setup, but not exactly the playing 11 kind of a player, but he is there. So he, in the midst of the protest, he said that the national team should boycott the upcoming, which is on the 13th. There is a Africa Cup of Nations qualifier against Sierra Leone happening in Nigeria. The national team shouldn't play, because all these national team players who play there across Europe in big leagues, they've all been tweeting, they've all been making their stance right. against these atrocities right. against the government on social media. So he said that we shouldn't play this match, and we should boycott it as protest. And then this happened last week, and this week he just backtracked. He apologized, saying that at the heat of the moment he made that comment. And I hope, I'm sure you can guess what the reason, what right. branding has happened, but. So he has been branded as unpatriotic, a different word for anti-national. So it's the same across country. If you look at it, US, there is a different version of it, and it happens underlying, and the control is always there. Here or Nigeria or many other countries, the control is much more direct and
right.
And despite the stardom. I'm just doubting whether any of these celebrated athletes are free.
Absolutely.
They are all slaves to the system. They happen to be slaves to the system.
Absolutely. Right. Thank you so much, Leslie, for talking to us.
That's all we have time for today. We'll be back tomorrow with more news from the country and the world. Until then, keep watching NewsClick.